Jonathon started getting into the environmental movement in about 1974. So I have to say, Jonathon, you've been doing this for almost as long as I've been alive.
Afraid you might say that.
And I also think what's really important about that is that when I start thinking about that, the enormous resilience you have to do this for that period of time. And, you know, I know when I look out in the audience, I see people who've been sustainability practitioners, and we talk about how hard it is and how much resilience we need. And so, you know, a huge amount of kudos for staying the course, because it's really important that we have people like you to look to say, actually, there is a way we can do this and we can keep going. Jonathon was the director of Friends of the Earth from 1984. And he set up Forum for the Future in 1996. And again, I know a number of you are working with that organisation. But the things which I think are really important, and they go back to my previous comments, are what Jonathon represents in terms of leadership. So I was on the Cambridge Institute for Sustainable Leadership, Prince of Wales, Ernst & Young, Sustainable Leadership Programme last week in Melbourne. It's the biggest title ever. And I had the opportunity to watch Jonathon in action, and I think I spend a lot of time thinking about leadership, because that's the stuff that we really need in the great acceleration. And what I saw is someone who can hold a line between compassion and the fact that we are all human and, you know, utterly fallible, but at the same time be able to hold us to a higher standard. And I watched Jonathon very skillfully push all of us to build aspiration and a sense of urgency. And in this time, it feels like there's never been a skill more important than that. And so when I was talking to Jonathon about what he would talk about tonight, what I said was, what I'd really like for you to do with us is to give us a sense of urgency, because we need that injection from time to time, but also a sense of our own agency, because we are all leaders in this room and we all have an opportunity to make a difference. And then the final thing that Jonathon and I talked a little bit about in Melbourne was this, and it's extremely important to me, and those of you who know me well know this, that we are not going to get any of this done unless we are having fun. And so I think it's the most important note to end this on, is that we need to make this fun as well. So please give in to your fun side as we do this. Don't be afraid to ask Jonathon questions. We will have a Q&A at the end, and we'll be getting questions from the guys on live stream. But it is really important that we find ways of enjoying this work too. So Jonathon, I hope that hasn't been too serious as I hand over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Abby. I feel I should just leave now, really. It was a fantastic evening. Jonathon went, but still, we got all the magic, so that was fine. But thank you. I really appreciate those words. And I suppose there is some value in having been around for so long that, my activism, like my span as an activist, is the equivalent of most people's lives. But you do have to develop a bit of a sense of the absurd. And I'm very conscious, I've been over here now in New Zealand and Australia for more than 2 weeks now. And once you've been doing this stuff for so long, you have to have a sense of the absurd. This is one of the ways in which you do increase your own capacity for resilience, is the ability to be amused by things which people definitely don't think are amusing, but nonetheless are indicative of the kind of slightly complicated position we're at in the moment. So just one thing hit me as I was walking here, which is so typical about how cities like Auckland cope with this stuff. So there's a little pedestrian precinct opposite Britomart station. And obviously the urban planners have gone crazy with the trees, and they've got some beautiful, I don't know what kind of trees they are, you know, but really solid-looking trees and great big planters, and they look wonderful. And you think to yourself, fantastic. And then you look up, and even in the middle of the day, they have the lights on. All day. And you think, they haven't quite got it. They're not quite joining up. And then I thought to myself, don't be too critical, Jonathon. They are light-emitting diodes. They are LEDs, so you ought to be grateful that they went for the most efficient way of wasting energy through lighting that you can possibly get. There is a serious point in this, of course. Some of you will be familiar, I'm sure, particularly those who work in the world of energy, with something called the Jevons paradox, which is every time you think you're going to make major reductions in energy consumption in society, lo and behold, people, citizens, take advantage of that efficiency gain to use that additional resource of whatever it might be, electrons or opportunities to go and fly somewhere else. They use that in such a way that they actually end up pretty much in the same position they were at before the efficiency commitment was made. And the Jevons paradox is one of those things that a lot of environmentalists are very nervous to mention, because we always give these big figures about how much money we're going to save if we do X, Y, or Z. And then you toss into the pot the Jevons paradox, and it's not quite as good as that, as you know. But anyway, so keep your eyes open for the absurd, because we all ought to walk around with a little notebook just to cheer ourselves up. My absurd moment of the day. Agency and urgency. It's a good start. Yeah, it's a good start. I mean, I'm not going to talk really about urgency as in the urgency messages we got while we were at this seminar in Australia, because this was full-on climate apocalypse-type urgency, as in we've got about 10 years, and if we don't do what we need to do in 10 years, we're pretty much dead. It was as simple as that. Slightly worse language was used to explain this. I'm being polite because I don't know some of you very well. I don't know some of you at all. But pretty much that the way the story is unfolding right now in terms of annual emissions of greenhouse gases and the knowledge that we now have about the available reserve that we can still fill in the atmosphere before we trip these various temperature thresholds, 2 degrees centigrade, 1.5 degrees centigrade, whatever it might be. The knowledge that we have about this now is really so good that we can make incredibly robust estimates of exactly how long we have on a business-as-usual basis before we crash through these various thresholds, starting with the 1.5, going to 2 degrees, and then upwards from there. And after that, you really are into full-on apocalypse, because obviously there ain't much to give us little rays of hope when you're into the zone of average 3 degrees centigrade by the end of the century, or 4 or even 5. I'm not going to do that this evening, you'll be happy to know, because I don't have as much time with you as we had with these poor, benighted victims in Melbourne, when we could whack them around the head on day one, and then through a complicated process of psychological therapy, really, get them to the position at the end of the time together where they thought, yeah, well, still looks pretty apocalyptic, but maybe there's stuff we can do, which is where the agency kicks in. And honestly, as I'll come back to in my concluding comments, it doesn't, in a funny kind of way, it doesn't really matter whether it's too late or not. It doesn't subtract from the urgency of what we know we have to do, which is really where I want to direct our attention around the leadership story. Yes, Forum was started in 1996. We had it easy, to be honest. We were made up of three members of the Green Party, quite radical in our orientation, still quite radical in our orientation, but nobody had really worked with business back in the mid-1990s in a genuinely trust-based critical friend role. And these are two very important aspects of the Forum's work. There has to be trust, because you're never going to have a good partnership unless you find out all the crap about some of your partners, as well as all the good stuff. And you cannot possibly fulfill the high objectives you might have for a partnership unless you can be really critical when criticism is merited. So you have to do both bits of this. And because it was relatively new in those days and NGOs were deeply suspicious about businesses and the bona fides of businesses and their locus, as it were, whether they had any real right to be involved in some of these big global processes, it was fantastically easy. Well, it didn't look easy at the time, but looking back on it, it was easy to begin to establish a modus operandi that allowed us to build a partnership base really quite quickly. And for the next 15 years, that served us pretty well. And during the course of that time, we watched this idea about corporate sustainability grow and change and evolve, getting more mature, taking on board more of the social and the economic agenda, even as it dealt with some of the core issues to do with climate, resources, waste, water, whatever it might be. We saw how companies began to get much better at partnership, so that now if you look around all the world leaders, on world corporate leaders on sustainability, you will find incredibly deep, dense partnership connections. We were asked some time ago, in a rather forlorn way, to do an analysis of all Unilever's partnerships across the company, because the chief finance officer was getting quite worried about the degree to which so much time and attention was being paid to working stuff through with other people and occasionally handing them out money, that he was getting quite worried about this. So he said, yeah, we can do this. We couldn't do it. It was literally impossible. It was literally impossible, because every single country, every single business unit, every single local facility, so there are 246 factories, each of those factories, manufacturing facilities of one kind or another, would have partnerships with people locally, each of the business units, and then, blow me down, each of the brands has now got complicated partnership arrangements, because they've discovered in Unilever, happily, that if you have what is called a purpose-driven brand, that brand grows faster than all the other brands in the Unilever portfolio. There's been a bit of pushback about this, by the way, from those other brands, because they don't like what not being a purpose-driven brand looks like. What would the description be? If you're not a purpose-driven brand, what kind of brand are you? Just a kind of bog standard, truck along kind of brand, doing the stuff we do, giving our consumers what they want at the price point they want it, with the reliability they need, but don't clutter up the relationship with our consumers with all this purpose stuff. So there's quite an interesting, quite sometimes quite feisty debate in Unilever. But we couldn't finish that piece of work, and we just said it's stupid and actually won't help you anyway. You just need to let this stuff rip. That is what good, mature corporate sustainability looks like for a global company, is allowing people to develop relationships to help them deliver what they need to be able to deliver against their own corporate targets and help put into play all of these societal benefits that will flow from complicated, sophisticated relationships with civil society. So Forum was very much part of that in the first 15 years. But we came to the conclusion, this is now about 6-7 years ago, that this wasn't really good enough. And this was a very difficult and painful moment in the Forum's history that usually I forget as fast as I can. It was painful because we asked ourselves the question, we had about 100 partners then. What would the Forum look like if we had 200 partners or 300 partners? And we were doing the same kind of stuff on a bilateral basis, company by company, trying to get them to change and be leaders in their space. Would the world be a better place? And we came to the really deeply uncomfortable conclusion the world would not be a better place. It would be slightly better because there'd be 300 companies all doing this good stuff, but the system wouldn't be changing. The big, broad system of which all of those companies are a part would not be changing. So from that point on, we've begun to push most of the Forum's resources into trying to establish these coalitions of organizations so that you can get bigger systemic change to achieve longer lasting, more resilient transformation in society as a whole. And it's bloody hard work, because companies are still a bit reluctant to kind of be corralled into a higher sense of purpose, often don't trust each other, don't really like the notion of pre-competitive collaboration, well, that's one of our favorite phrases, and can sometimes be very grumpy about the idea that doing things better on their own isn't sufficient. But trust me, it isn't. Interesting for us here in New Zealand, at the moment, Forum is gradually establishing itself in New Zealand, has been doing so for nearly four years now, starting with a wonderful and really important relationship with Air New Zealand that allowed us to reach out into many other parts of New Zealand business society, and Air New Zealand organized these amazing sustainability breakfasts, which somehow became, and they've only had two of them, but nonetheless, they became kind of cult events, to my astonishment, And I had to tell Christopher Luxon, the chief executive of Air New Zealand, that I'd never actually been to a breakfast event that had 450 people attending it. Because I suppose they just don't think like that in the UK. But it created a bit of a sense of excitement and, oh, okay, bloody hell, this is an airline. This is an airline. This is not just any old company that can relatively easily get itself on the right side of the risk register or do the right stuff when it comes to building value through more sustainable goods and services, or find smart ways of innovating itself out of complicated positions it's in at the moment. It's really difficult if you're an airline, and I'm looking at Catherine here from the Air New Zealand team. It's genuinely difficult. So the fact that it was Air New Zealand was enormously helpful, because if we can't think about ways in helping massive, globally significant sectors to undertake that journey with intent, with sincerity, and with clear leadership, then, you know, doing the easy stuff doesn't really count. So for us, that was a great start in New Zealand, and we're now delighted to be working with a number of other companies, which is fantastic. We're working with Vector now, which is absolutely great. We're working with the Ports of Auckland, which is fantastic. And we are also working with Fonterra, which is equally fantastic and suitably challenging for an organization like ours that likes to put, as someone said to us when we were doing our due diligence, I'm not sure Carolyn knows this story, when we were doing our due diligence, they said, yeah, Jonathon, there you go again. You do love putting yourself in harm's way, don't you? I took that as a sort of vote of approval, really, because, again, sustainable nutrition, protein for 9.5 billion people by 2050, the contribution that dairy can make to that, the contribution that innovation can make to that, these are vast questions. And when you get a company that is capable of being a major player in that world, it's more than a sector, this is an absolutely huge world. You'd be crazy not to do it. You'd be crazy to do it, but even crazier not to do it. So it's gradually grown a bit piecemeal, but we've now come to the conclusion that not only is it really good fun working in New Zealand, thank you, Abby, but that there is materiality here. There's stuff to be done. And there is a chance to make some bigger changes, actually, in a country like this than might be the case elsewhere, which is what we're gunning for, what we're talking now to chief executives of some of the government departments to see what we can do to push them into a more dynamic sense of opportunity with leading companies in New Zealand, which is really, really crucial. So that's how we ended up in New Zealand. But at the moment, we're still doing single company relationships. We're not yet doing the wider system change stuff. But we started to talk about that, particularly with Vector, how you would begin to think through a much wider systemic change in the energy system for New Zealand, because there's a real opportunity to do that pretty dramatically. When I was in Gisborne, because we went with Air New Zealand to Gisborne to look at some projects that they're thinking of doing down there to encourage regional development and make sure that people understand that if Air New Zealand's going to be in a community, it's got to be in a community with purpose and with intent. And so we were talking a lot about economic development in one of the poorest regions in New Zealand and what a big company can do by way of strategic community investment. And actually, for us, that's now becoming a very big part of the story. How can companies use their net assets effectively to create value for society, even as they continue to create value for their shareholders? That really is the deal. That's the deal. It's a tough deal. And we are, in many respects, I think, struggling to articulate that in the right kind of way. 3 weeks ago, there was a big new report released by the Business and Sustainable Development Commission, body set up immediately after the publication of the Sustainable Development Goals in 2015. Big new report. It's really interesting to have a look at it. It's a kind of classic on-the-cusp type of report, reflecting some of the old-world corporate sustainability views, but moving into some very interesting new space as well. The old bit of it was all about identifying new sources of economic value. So $12 trillion worth of new economic value to be had in sorting out things like poverty and access to water and sanitation and disease and education and so on. Now, a little bit of me still feels really uncomfortable when people lead on trillions of dollars of economic value to be had from doing what really and truly we know should be done, even if there was zero economic value to be had for private sector operations. So the $12 trillion, for me, is a little bit ambiguous. I'm delighted when companies get excited about it because it means they will think a little bit more about what the SDGs mean to them, how they can play to the SDGs, work through their own opportunities there, their own partnerships, etc., etc. But the new bit is much more interesting for me because the report is extremely outspoken about the degree to which business has lost the trust of civil society. Since the GFC, since the crash, if you look at the statistics, and there was a new report, the Edelman Barometer came out on, was it Wednesday or Tuesday, I can't remember which, here in New Zealand, which is an annual kind of check-in that shows you degrees of trust that people have in government, business, and civil society. So the results of that were very similar. But if you go back 10 years, you can see a gradual decline in levels of trust in people who work for the private sector, particularly big companies. When you actually dissect the figures a little bit more carefully, people don't actually feel anything like the same level of antagonism towards people who work in small and medium-sized companies, or people who work in startups that they've created, or people who are so clearly involved in their community that there really isn't any reason not to like them and be supportive of what they're doing. We're talking mostly about big companies, particularly about big global multinational companies. And here in New Zealand, the level of trust over the last year has fallen by 4%. Trust in business has fallen by 4% in just 1 year. That's significant. You kind of think to yourself, whoa, bloody hell, what's that all about? And what makes this bit of the report so interesting is the absolutely unambiguous assertion that the corporate sector will never be able to play a leading role in shaping a better world for people unless it can rebuild that trust, unless it can establish a different pattern of relationships with key stakeholders, with its customers, so they don't feel exploited and ripped off, with its business partners, particularly small businesses, who often feel ruthlessly abused by larger companies in terms of late payments, non-payments, all the rest of it. With regulators, who often feel that companies are playing fast and loose with the minimum that they're asked to do through the laws of the land, and I do mean minimum regarding some laws here in New Zealand, as you know. I promised not to go back into the zone of wadeable water anymore because I've kind of done that one, and I am reliably assured that the government now is absolutely on track to get out of wadeable water and into swimmable water, which is fantastic, fantastic. This is absolutely the right direction to be travelling in. So you can see that there are so many ways in which companies lose that sense of trust because they are abusive of critical relationships. And they're abusive of the role they play in communities. And they're not good enough in terms of the ways in which they treat their staff. All of these things are part of the wider sustainability picture. It's why Forum has always been absolutely clear, don't even go down the story of sustainable development unless you're prepared to do full spectrum sustainability, dealing with all of these different issues. I don't care what you call them, what your headings are, what your pillars are, it doesn't really matter. As long as you're addressing all the issues to do with people inside a company, with communities in which companies are based, with consumers, with natural capital, as we call it, with the natural assets that companies are dealing with the whole story about how you create economic wealth in such a way that it's more inclusive, and so on and so forth. The report calls for a new social contract between business and civil society. It's the right challenge. Sure, it's the right terminology, but it's the right challenge. And one of the things that we all have to think about when we're addressing this complicated balancing act between leadership and agency is how can we contribute to that? What, in a small way, can we contribute to rebuilding that trust, to creating a new social contract between the wealth creators on whom we depend in very large measure for continuing levels of innovation, of investment, of all sorts of things, huge benefits that those companies put into the public domain. How can each company contribute that? Now, that's the deal. It's quite hard because the bloody politicians will not change the rules of the game. They will not change the rules of the growth game because the growth game is still the only game in town. Well, the only game in the universe as far as governments are concerned. If everything can't be seen to result in an increase in GDP or some easily measurable pickup in conventional growth-based criteria, then the politicians really and truly don't want to know. So one of the few really bad things about having been involved in this for as long as I have been is that when I wrote the Green Party's manifesto in 1979, you see, and urged politicians at that time, not necessarily to move towards a zero growth economy, I'm not that stupid, but at least to start opening up the debate about what we need to do to make growth better for people today and better for everybody who comes after us in the future. What do we need to do? And in essence, it's remarkably simple, but clearly not for the politicians. Because really all we have to do is to make the growth that we have in our economy socially inclusive, which means that the benefits, the distributed surpluses in that growth economy need to be shared much more equitably than has been the case over the last 25 years, where we've had a particularly rapacious, vicious form of capitalism, which has allowed the very wealthy to suck wealth out of everybody else's sense of material well-being to the vast detriment of society as a whole. And when you hear this phrase, the left behind, in the USA, in the UK, in all sorts of countries now, people have literally been left behind. Incomes have flatlined, their sense of opportunity has got stuck, and the most shocking thing of all, and this is truly shocking, many of them believe that the prospects of their children will be less good than the prospects that they had. As in the whole arc of progress that one generation creates enough by way of building the conditions for future wealth to allow the next generation to stand on their shoulders and continue to improve. More and more people in these surveys believe that the lot of future generations will be worse than our lot today. That's staggering. And a lot of that is to do with social exclusion caused by a very, very poor form of capitalism. And the second thing, of course, is to have growth, if you can, without the massive physical, environmental externalities that we have today. I know it's amazing easy to say that, and you'll all have a firm grip, of course, of the arcane economic theory of externalities, which is when wealth creators dump the costs of some of their production onto the environment at large and don't pay the real price. So that price is not built into their economic financial results, but of course the cost is paid for. Somebody has to pay for these costs at some point in the economy. There is no such thing as a free lunch in a finite environment. It's a little bit shocking when you do the really hard-edged analysis about what it means to internalize all the costs involved that companies can currently get away with by dumping those costs onto the environment. And it's nearly 10 years now since the company Puma, did a really smart bit of work, spent a ton of money. Everybody was more astonished by the amount of money they spent on it than they were by the end result, but I'm sticking with the end result here. Did an absolutely astonishing piece of work showing that if they had been held to account for the cost of all their externalities on the physical environment. They would have made no profit whatsoever. So the surplus that Puma distributed to its grateful shareholders at the end of the financial year was essentially a subsidy from nature. It wasn't truly earned surplus by genius of the amazing people in Puma. It was earned by virtue of their ability to suck subsidy out of the natural world. And I can pretty much guarantee that if you were to do the same sort of exercise, you may not have quite such a shocking result. You'd probably come up with something that looked almost as painful. Yeah. Funnily enough, not many companies have repeated this exercise. So you kind of have to ask, what does that tell us? Does it tell us that companies are very keen on transparency, theoretically, but not when it comes to something that touches the inviolability of the profit line? So the reason why I now want to end by reminding you that any person involved in the world of corporate sustainability has to go one step further, as if everything I said wasn't far enough, and I know it's kind of completely stupid, to think about companies doing this in the teeth of sort of complex government procrastination and consumer indifference, but we have to go one step further. And this is all about voice. This is about the way in which companies now speak to these issues. The way in which they begin to get citizens, not just consumers, but citizens, to think carefully about the changes we need in the economy as a whole to ensure we can have the kind of growth that is socially inclusive and doesn't screw the environment. Now, honestly, if I was sitting in front of a bunch of Green Party MPs, which I was last night, so this is fresh in my mind, and I ended my speech on that kind of note, they'd say, get off, it's bollocks, we can't have that kind of growth. You know you can't do socially inclusive, non-externalizing growth. It doesn't work, we're gonna have to go beyond growth completely. And I'm still in the place that says there's the politically impossible and then there's the politically, completely, permanently impossible. Okay, and right now, it's nearly impossible to work with politicians to get them to change the line of rhetoric, get them to think more intelligently about exponential permanent economic growth on a finite planet. It's such a hard job, so why make it even harder than it would be otherwise? But it was wonderful for me to be in Wellington yesterday. It was quite a special day. During the day, I don't know whether any of you were watching the coverage of what was happening in Parliament. What a stupid thing to say. Sorry. Okay, I'd take that back. You would not have been watching the coverage of what was happening in Parliament yesterday, but it was a really amazing day yesterday because it was the day on which Parliament confirmed the granting of the status of a person to the Whanganui River. Yay. I mean, New Zealand is so far ahead on this stuff, it is unbelievable. It's the most exciting thing. And it matters to me personally. My dad was born in Whanganui, and it was one of the first places where I stayed when I came out to New Zealand, got to know it reasonably well, and for me I wouldn't say it's got a deep spiritual resonance because I don't know it well enough, but it touches me in a way that I suppose most other rivers in New Zealand wouldn't touch me because I don't know them well enough. But this for me was a really extraordinary thing, and it shows, it does show that if we combine the best of the two cultures we have in New Zealand, it really is possible to open up very different ways of thinking about prosperity in the future. And there aren't a lot of countries that can do that at the moment. So I'm always under the strictest admonition to end on an upbeat note, which I have duly done. Thank you.
Thank you, Jonathon. I think that was fun too. So we've got some time for questions and answers, and also we've got people on the end of live stream. If you've got questions, make sure you put them in through the system, and Kate is somewhere here, she's going to read them for me if you've sent any in. So Anne has got her hand up. Anne, shall I pass you the microphone so the people on live stream can hear you?
And if you could say which organisation you're from, that would be wonderful for me, so that I don't,
hello.
So that I'm not inadvertently rude.
Hello, Jonathon. It's nice to see you again. Anne Smith from Environment Solutions. If you hadn't raised the Whanganui River, I was going to. So the question I've got is, if you made the environment a shareholder in Puma,
yep,
could they sort things out to make a profit?
Yeah. No, the great thing about that exercise, and actually it sounded as if I was being critical about Puma, and that's not fair. The great thing about that exercise was that they learnt so much about where these external costs were going and how unnecessary a lot of it was. And particularly from the point of view of sourcing raw materials differently and, of course, reducing the energy intensity of each bit of clothing or each pair of trainers, whatever it might be, by going after the quite simple efficiency gains available to companies, they have, from that point on, they've never done a full-blown return to that study, but from that point on, they have shown, year after year, significant reductions in those externalities. So could they do it on such a basis that they would be genuinely profitable without any externalized cost? I very much doubt that. And that's where government kicks in again, because until you've got incentives to go the whole way, it's quite hard to do that. You know, if government's incentivized a move towards renewable energy, not just renewable electricity, but renewable energy in a much smarter way than they're inclined to do, you know, you could see some pretty dramatic change coming through the system pretty quickly, to be honest. So I'm confident that knowledge is the precondition of good management. And companies that are well led are very mindful of having access to the best possible data. Mm. It sounds a really geeky thing to say, sorry. But honestly, that data, the gathering of that data, without it, it's touch and go whether you're actually making the interventions at the right point in the system or whether you're wasting money. You know, you never quite know unless you are really on top of the data.
Mm. And I've got Malcolm, Juhi, and then Simon. So,
hi, I'm Malcolm Rands from Fairground Foundation and EcoStore. Look, I've been a big champion for years of business can make the difference, right? But how important is government to set the rules, and how do we get the voters to actually elect the right government?
Well, I think I've already given a pretty clear steer that without government, even the most progressive company is going to do less than it would otherwise be able to do. Because governments are the enablers. They frame the markets. And they frame markets through setting standards at the right level, through thinking through the balance of taxation and incentivization, through legislation. You know, they enable markets. This is a critical role. And what, not only that, they also have a mandate, for God's sake. For better or for worse, people do elect them. It's a bit tricky coping with that right now, as we all know. But you tell me there's been a very good result in the Netherlands today, so thank you for that. Otherwise, I might be feeling even more glum than I would be every time I think about the USA or the UK. How do you get voters to see this? Well, it was quite funny. When we were in Australia, literally there was a question from somebody in one of the sessions. Says, you know, what we really need to persuade voters, we've just got to have a burning platform out there. I'd just come out of a meeting about what Sydney felt like with temperatures of 47 degrees centigrade. I've only ever once been a place where the temperature reached 47 degrees centigrade, which was in the middle of the Abu Dhabi desert, and it was not nice. And this was the temperature that they recorded in the center of Sydney. And I thought to myself, how much more of a burning platform do you need? There comes a point where you just think, God, really, maybe we do just need not just another climate shock, but I don't know. I used to have this when I was feeling really uncharitable, which I do occasionally. I am most of the time I'm quite charitable towards those who I have total contempt for. But when I was feeling really gloomy, I would think about a selective tsunami on Miami. Because Miami was responsible, you may recall, for the election of George Bush by frauding the entire system. So they deserve something in terms of, you know, the Wheel of Fortune. Miami is definitely due one, okay. And I have often speculated about how could you engineer a kind of selective tsunami that would take out the whole of Miami, no deaths, of course. I'm not in the business of inflicting unnecessary deaths on even citizens of Miami. How would you do this? How could this happen? Because you saw somehow something's got to go so bad, so big, so fast, that even the idiots in America who continue to deny the science of climate change would say, oh shit, okay, no further. No further debate about this. Let's get on with it. But what would that look like? We've got a man in the EPA now. Oh God, Scott Pruitt, who looks actually disturbingly like George Bush. It's quite upsetting when you see him. In an answer to an interview question earlier in the week, he was asked, did he agree with the scientific consensus that CO2 was the primary driver of climate change? To which the answer, as you can imagine, was no, I do not agree with that. I don't think the evidence shows us that CO2 is the primary driver. So we've got a full-on climate denier running the Environmental Protection Agency in the USA. Yeah, that's tricky. I don't know. I'm not going to give up on this. I'm not going to give up on democracy as the best way to secure a more sustainable world, because the answer has to be in democracy. If you don't want to do democracy, you can only do autocracy, which means various shades of kind of nastiness all the way through from managerial urban capitalism like Singapore all the way through to full-on dictatorial autocratic rule in China. If that's the only way we can get to a sustainable world, I'm not sure the game's worth the candle, personally. I have to say, a lot of my friends are wavering. What? What is this democracy stuff, John? You'd be quite a good dictator. You've got dictatorial tendencies. Surely you'd like to give those an airing late in your life, you know? It's true, they do.
I hope this isn't your election pitch. Not quite.
Vote for me as your best dictator.
Hi, thank you so much, Jonathon. It's Juhi Sharif from Fuji Xerox. Just to add something to the conversation, not a specific question, just to say that I know that, so Puma is part of the caring group that have started accounting for their externalities through their environmental profit and loss accounting system. And from what I understand is that actually putting things in monetary terms has started to create change in all of the brands, so the Gucci's and the Stella McCartney's and so on. And they are starting to realize the impacts, and they're mostly around the raw materials. I was just wondering if you knew of any other kind of groups or organizations that are starting to address this.
Yes, luxury brands are particularly complicated to deal with. It's a kind of down at heel, anti-consumerist ascetic who goes shopping for clothes once every 3 years. It's a little bit hard for me to cope with luxury brands, but I have to challenge myself, which is why I'm an advisor, putting myself in harm's way. I'm an advisor to an organization called Positive Luxury. And I've spent an awful lot of time trying to persuade the founder of Positive Luxury not to use that title, but oh no. And of course, the Kering Group is a member of this, and Burberry is doing a lot of stuff. And there are quite a lot of luxury brands now which are catching up, to be honest. They're mostly in catch-up mode, because if you're a luxury brand, your consumers, by and large, may not be as mindful of the impact on people, communities, and planet through the supply chain as some other people might be. That's a horrible generalization. I apologize to all consumers of luxury product, but I don't care. You know, it won't. Sorry. Give your money away and buy cheap. Cheap, but ethical, obviously. So there are groups that are doing this now. And actually, we probably should celebrate the fact that luxury brands are getting into the story. The world revolves around often frighteningly small cohorts of frighteningly wealthy and influential people. And it's hard to say this, but if you're really talking about 1% of the 1% who have massive disproportionate influence over the way the world works, you might say, if you did your detailed analysis about where could you get the maximum impact, you might say, there. Because every one of the 1% of the 1% that can be brought into a zone of ethical and sustainable sanity, the better the world might be. You know, if we did this on a strictly impact-related analysis, where can you get the biggest bang for the whatever amount of money you've got available to you, you might say those luxury brands might change the minds of a large number of luxury consumers who will then become hugely proactive advocates for a more sustainable world.
Kardashians.
Sorry?
Kardashians.
You do like a challenge, don't you? Or Russian billionaires. I did once do a meeting for a group of Russian billionaires. This was not what I thought it was. I was invited to go and give a talk to a group of people who wanted to open up new opportunities to do sustainable forestry in Russia. And I thought, that sounds good. You know, we've got a lot of forest. We need to have it managed sustainably. And I bowled up to discover this group of really frighteningly intense Russian oligarchs and billionaires, and it was one of the most enlivening conversations I've ever had, really. I don't think it mattered that not many of them liked me at the end of it. Well, none of them took me out, let's put it like that. They didn't dislike me that much, as in a little message the next day, but so. Yeah, Russian oligarchs, they're troublesome.
Hi, Jonathon. Great to see you back here again. So I'm Simon Harvey from Proxima Consulting, sustainability consultancy firm, and also from The Natural Step. And I'd like to thank you for your involvement in that organisation over the years. Ourselves and the network are very grateful for that. Just picking up on Malcolm's question, and because my sort of original thought was, you know, politicians, you know, we might not like them, but it's hard to blame them when they're really essentially in service to the people who've put their hand up to say, look, we want you to represent us. And it takes me back to another point. It says, you know, how do we enable and help people to have better choices about who they elect? And that took me to another point, which is really the question, because you've answered that one, is and it's sparked by a documentary which is out at the moment around unschooling, about how we educate our children.
Yep.
And one of the points of that is that the easiest way to destroy a culture is by the way you educate them. And they referred, of course, specifically to, you know, what the British did over the years in different places and other cultures as well. And I just wondered your thought, you know, how do we actually gear our education system up so that the young people coming through have a really clear sense, regardless of which socioeconomic sector they come from, they just get it and are able to make great choices for, you know, as they grow older.
Yeah. Well, there's apparently, I haven't read it yet, but there's a great new book out in the States. So I just read a little article about it, which I tweeted about, because I'm fascinated in this whole story about the role of nature in education. I used to be a teacher for 10 years myself, taught in a Wild West school in London, which was wonderful. And we got permission from our truly enlightened head teacher, who was way before her time, and obviously I was an activist in the Green Party in those days while I was teaching, so she knew I was a bit dodgy. But she sort of had an instinct about how to help these kids living in these horrendous estates in West London. And with her active encouragement, we set up this mad thing where we'd lug about, in the end, 6 groups of 20 kids off to Wales to teach them about the land and about farming and about countryside and so on. And ever since then, and I was kind of in charge of that, before the days of health and safety, okay, we'd just get a scribble note from the parents, we'd chuck him in the back of the minivan, off we'd go, and God knows, nobody died on that particular watch, thankfully, even though we did do somewhat crazy things like take them into the woods late at night, because these are very cocky, tough kids. They think they know it all, but they'd never been in darkness before, because the estates they live in have those horrible yellow sodium lights. So literally none of these kids had ever experienced darkness. And even more extraordinary, they'd never experienced silence. Because the motorway pounds past 24 hours a day. So the toughest of kids could be reduced practically to a palpitating ball of fear by taking him into the woods and tying them to a tree. And I recommend it. I do actually recommend it. It's brilliant. It gets them right into the place that you want them in, which is a bit less cocky and up for new experiences. I'm absolutely passionate about this story about enabling young people to spend as much time as possible in the natural world. And what I liked about this book, so stupid recommending books before you've read them, but what I liked about the sound of this book was that it put the emphasis very much on health. Because of the data now, the really strong data, about how kids that are able to connect with the natural world on a regular basis, daily basis, are healthier, better off in themselves, increased sense of well-being, satisfaction, and guess what that leads to? Higher attainment, higher grades, higher educational results, better educational results. So her whole, the author's line on this was, okay, you may think this is all a bunch of pagan crap, that we should put kids into the natural world, not necessarily tying them to trees, we should put them into the natural world and give them a chance to relate to the natural world. Even if you think that's rubbish, if your concern is the well-being of each individual child, the quality of the educational experience they're getting, and the degree to which they're enabled to perform better in schools, what do you think is wrong with this empirical database? Now, we're talking about America, okay. Empirical databases don't mean quite as much in America these days as they once did. In fact, I can pretty much guarantee that Scott Pruitt has already tweeted about this being fake data, that kids are happier in nature. But honestly, and I've been active in this world for a long time. I'm patron of two organizations that organize opportunities for city kids to get out into the natural world. It's a big part of what I think is really important. I'm only scraping the surface here, but let's start with the one thing which we know would make a difference, which is opportunities to engage and keep engaging with the natural world, not just through those primary years, but on into.
One of the things that springs to my mind is as simple as this, and we know it from the work that we do with businesses to help them understand, you know, what is this all about? Why is that? Why are things going wrong? And it's just making the connection between, you know, chemistry, physics, and biology in terms of, you know, the way we make things like this and what we do with them, or the way we do stuff. And I just wonder why, you know, those subjects haven't been better connected in the educational system to say, you know, you learn about them individually, but when you put them together, you understand why life thrives and why it doesn't thrive. So it's kind of that simple. People seem to get it. I'm sure kids would get it even quicker.
Some would. You're dragging me outside of whatever zone of comfort I might have regarding science. I can recommend a book that sounds, if you absolutely love it, because it's completely on that message. It is 625 pages long of intensely brilliant esoteric science written by a man called E.O. Wilson, and it's called Consilience. And what you just said is his mission in life, is to get the different disciplines to see what it is that they share from the roots they come from, and come up with a much better way of teaching science to kids. I don't know if it's still in print. It's just one of those books that I found so hard. You know, it's always the ones that find so hard that stick in your mind.
So we've got time for one more question, and we've got one from our friends on the end of the live stream. So I'm going to hand over to Kate for it.
So this question is on behalf of Sam Bridgman from New Zealand Post. He's really interested in your view on what effect Donald Trump and the gentleman from the EPA you mentioned will have on progress for sustainable development. Is it a long-term handbrake, or can we just carry on and get stuff done?
Should we take the other question as well? Did you say there's another question? Because I'm mindful of, not only do I have to end my talk on a high note, I also have to end the Q&A on a high note. And I kind of know that that question is not, going to go
question.
There.
Catherine, will your question enable Jonathon to end on a high note?
Yeah.
Okay, so Catherine, you give Jonathon the question as well.
My question was about, so I'm Catherine from Air New Zealand. My question is about picking up on what you said earlier about the potential for system level change in New Zealand, the potential for pre-competitive collaboration. I know it's not something that Forum, you said, it's not something Forum's worked on hugely in New Zealand yet, but I'm interested in the potential you see. Currently, SBC, I'm involved in one of the SBC programs around climate action groups, which is very much coming from bottom up, top down, what can we do to hasten the low carbon transition? And we're buzzing a lot of ideas around, from pledges to communities of learning to communications campaigns. But I'm really interested in what you think really makes that kind of collaborative system level work sing.
Yep.
Some examples we can potentially learn from here.
Excellent. Right, I'm going to take your question, or the gentleman's question first. Thank you. There are two ways of addressing that question. The first is that Donald Trump will be massively destructive for the period of time that he is in the White House. And there are more and more people who think he will only be in the White House for 4 years. And they think that because in just 50 days, he's made so many cock-ups, and he's just so duplicitous. And people are beginning to think, you know, this isn't right to have a president of this kind representing the USA. So there are a lot of people who think he'll only be there for the four years. We need him, by the way, to stay for 4 years, because were he to leave in the intervening 4 years, his vice president is so horrendous, this man called Mike Pence. He's Donald Trump plus religion. Okay, this is so awful, it's almost impossible to imagine. So we need the man to do the full 4 years. And what you will find in the US right now is a distinct and massively encouraging recalibration of progressive political forces. And whichever way you turn, whichever way you look at it, this is going on everywhere. And I'm loving this, and I've sort of keyed into some of the key places where you can find this information about how resilient people are now in the face of the Donald Trump phenomenon. So take a tiny example. A very small group of women scientists who would communicate with each other by a Facebook group before Donald Trump's election, but not really with a view to doing very much, just, you know, to express how hard it was probably in their own workplace and so on and so forth, and started out as a small group of 10 people, and now there's something like 48,000 women in this, women scientists in this group. Because, as they say right at the start of what they're saying, we are dealing with a double whammy. Okay, so we're dealing, well, I won't go into the language they use because it's quite feisty, as you can imagine, but having in Donald Trump a man who is clearly deeply misogynistic, sexist, hateful from the point of view of women in every regard, and deeply, deeply anti-science, means that every woman scientist in the USA is thinking about, whoa, okay, maybe this is the moment where I come out of my little specialist bunker and I start defending A, women, and B, science. Because if I don't start doing that now, who knows what's going to happen in another 4 years? So you've got tons of these kind of resurgent groupings of people who weren't particularly active before, really didn't like the Democrats, didn't think Hillary Clinton was going to do anything other than keep the old status quo running for another 4 or 8 years, couldn't get any sense of excitement about the need for change, and so, you know, they never bothered. So I'm really quite hopeful about that, but it does mean 4 years where the attack is going to be non-stop. So I've been reading the things in the Trump pipeline that he is going to roll out to further eviscerate the work of the EPA, of science agencies. There's an amazing organization called the National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Research Body, NOAA. Just a kind of source of expertise that you can't, you just, it is so astonishing how much knowledge and insight they've put into the scientific world over the last 30, 40 years. He's now going after them on the grounds that they're all partisan and that their science is therefore dodgy. So the damage is going to be severe, and I don't think anybody ought to be under any illusion that it's not going to be easy. So, you see, I told you that one wouldn't end well. Pre-competitive collaboration in New Zealand. Good thought. And I think, Abby, we've occasionally touched on this because there are many opportunities, really, where New Zealand can perhaps do things that other countries can't. I mean, I don't want to say this in any way that you will misinterpret, but the fact that New Zealand is quite a small country, that an awful lot of people do know an awful lot of other people, and that there are opportunities to share expertise in ways that are more direct, personal, speaks to the possibility of good collaboration. So take the whole notion of the circular economy, which everybody's very excited about. I just to let you know that the world has been going yabba, 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 yabba about the circular economy for the best part of 10 years. And the wonderful Dame Ellen MacArthur, against whom I will not hear a single word of criticism, who set up the Circular Economy 100, has been putting fantastic reports into the public domain about the power of the circular economy for a very long time, 10 years. But at the moment, the activation of these ideas in our economies is still pretty primitive. So if I look at that, no one company can really address some of the structural wastage in a sector, in any particular sector, on its own. It's just not possible. So if you think about ways of strategically combining forces to bring about change, it might be change purely within the business community, it might be change in terms of saying to government, you know what, you've got a really amazing opportunity to do something intelligent here to help New Zealand move on to a more circular economy. I'm pretty struck by land-based opportunities in New Zealand. We had some fascinating discussions at the advisory board of Air New Zealand, of course, looking at the ETS and what New Zealand could do now. New Zealand's one of the very few countries to have a pretty serious domestic ETS, which will go to 100% within 3 years, 2019. It doesn't generate a vast amount of money, but it generates real money that companies can't not provide, at least those companies that are in the ETS. And you'd probably want all companies to be in the ETS in one way or another. But there are fantastic land-based opportunities to start thinking about New Zealand's natural capital assets in more holistic, joined-up ways. And we don't know enough about these stories yet to really play a role in that. But hopefully, as we get to know the company's better and we get to see what the opportunities are, this is the place where we'd like to be, because that's where you can make bigger, longer lasting change. Which means I'm coming back. There's a positive note to end on. Well, for me at least.
Thank you. And that is a positive note. Thank you, Jonathon. We are always delighted to have you back. There are two things that struck me as you spoke, and one of them is a reflection on being on the Cambridge course last week. And actually, I meant to say huge thanks to Toyota, who sponsored me to attend that, and the course itself, which subsidised my fees. But one of the things is that how do we connect with that kind of international sense of where the kind of energy is, but also bring our New Zealanders to it as well. And I think one of the things which was really evident to me on the course was hanging out with a bunch of Australians. There were about eight or ten Kiwis and 30 Australians. And I'm reminded every time I'm in those sorts of circumstances that culturally we are unique, and there are some things about New Zealand, being New Zealander, that makes us different. And I think some of those are great leadership opportunities, and I think some of them are great leadership challenges. And so I think it's a conversation that we always need to keep having about how we shift our system in New Zealand, because one of the things that Kate and I have learned, and I can say, hand on heart, oh my God, we have learned so many lessons from trying to use a systems thinking approach in the climate work, is that there are unique features of New Zealand that make the things which have worked overseas harder, and there are some things that are unique about New Zealand that make some things easier. So my encouragement to all of us is just to keep talking about how we're working and sharing what we're learning, because that's the way that we'll get the system to shift faster. And then my second reflection is about storytelling, because we didn't talk about it. But do you know what I'll tweet after this? That Jonathon Porritt tied a child to a tree.
Must you?
No, I probably won't, because I need people to continue to, you know, think that you're credible. But but it goes to the importance of storytelling. And thank you, Jonathon. You've done that extraordinarily well. And you know, it's my great joy to watch you do these things, because I learn so much from the how of what you do. So thank you all for coming out tonight. We'll be able to have some more drinks and nibbles afterwards, so stay if you can. Jonathon can't stay hugely long, so it'll be kind of mob mentality, I'd imagine, so be ready for that. At least you spent some time in New Zealand when you were younger, so you know you've probably got some good rugby moves you can deploy. Thank you, everyone, for being here tonight. Thank you to all of those who were on the live stream. Fantastic to have you there. And with that, good night.